Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners.
Hello and welcome to Special Stage. We're here in Wales where it's lovely weather, dry, still, sunny, perfect rallying conditions really. We're here for round one of the Mintex British Historic Rally Championship. But before we head out and see some of the action on the stages this morning, we caught up with a couple of the crews at the start. It's obviously quite a mixed end to the season last year, but overall you came out on top. How does that leave you feeling today?
Yeah, it's a bit, you know, it's in the back of your mind. We had a crash 5 months ago and to do nothing since, you know, you were going to think about it at the start line, but as soon as we get to the first corner, it'll be out of my mind and concentrate on the day.
Are you hoping that your new car behaves a little bit better today, Matthew?
Well, it behaved itself last week, really. We did the cambium there as a shakedown and everything that could go wrong went wrong, really. So we didn't get the best of runs, really, but the boys have fettled up this week and we'll try again, eh?
Before we head to the stages, here's a quick and simple guide to the categories you'll see throughout the show. Category 1, the pre-1968 cars. Typically, this is where you'll find the most variety, with minis, cortinas and a host of unique cars. This category will probably see bigger numbers on the asphalt rounds rather than the gravel. Category 2, following on from the end of Category 1 and up to 1974, home to the Mark 1 Escorts. But you'll still find a bit of variety in this category as well. Category 3, this is likely where the event winner will come from. With dates just breaching into the 1980s, this is where the Mark 2 Escort is dominant. But as with other categories, there's still some variety mixing up the results. As well as those three main categories, we have a few other entries, such as Category K, for cars built to FIA Appendix K regulations. But with the similarities to Category 3, we'll keep those two together for the purpose of the show. Onto the stages then, two in this first loop, and the weather certainly wasn't ideal. We caught up with one of the championship tyre suppliers for his opinion on what the crews would be running today.
It's obviously been a pretty wet few days here.
Absolutely,
in Wales,
yeah.
So what does that mean for tyre choice?
Obviously quite a softish compound, very open block tread, the best that we can offer. We've got the KM6, which is our most aggressive tyre. Some guys will take the medium compound. It's not very, very cold, it's quite warm in fact. So to get the most of the mechanical grip, I think we'll go for a medium tyre on the rear of the Escorts, maybe a softer tyre on the front. So it's quite messy in some of the stages, but some of the stages are also quite abrasive, so yeah, it should be good. Should be good. Looking forward to it.
Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark start the new season off in the best possible way. They take an early but small lead of just 5 seconds. That position was being helped by the misfortunes of Nick Elliott and Dave Price. They could have been leading if it hadn't been for a stall midway through stage one, the car not restarting and losing the pair valuable time in the process. They do at least manage second place.
Roll it back, it's bump it.
And that will be the place they only just managed to keep, with Joe Price and Chris Brooks actually on an identical time overall, missing out with that stage one time, but for now, third place was theirs, even with a spin mid-stage.
Are they gone? Are they?
Yeah.
45 left, we're nice and tidy to the end now. 80, 5 right, continues to 100, then tightens to 2 right long. Tightens to 2 right long. Need to get out of this stage. And one left plus bumpy.
With the last outing being September and that event not ending well, Paul Barrett and Di Roberts would be settling in slowly here at round one. Or at least that's what they were telling everyone. They actually reached the end of stage two with 4th overall and leading the class. A cat amongst the pigeons for Matthew Robinson and Sam Collis would be a good way to describe the plans for the year, bringing out the newly developed Fiat 131 with a longer term goal of being an Escort beater. For now, it would be 5th place. Problems for Steve Bennett and Ian Tully in the first couple of stages were doing the confidence no good. The intercom failing and the pair would be taking it easy, not wanting a repeat of the track road crash from the end of last season. Sixth place for the pair now. And that would be a time they shared with Simon Webster and Jez Rogers, still feeling there would be more to give in the next stage, just taking a little time to get back into it. Eighth in the category at this stage were Tim Freeman and Paul Williams. They had, however, flattened the exhaust in stage one, meaning that notes were hard to hear due to the noise. And for Rudy Lancaster and George Gwynn, it would be seat problems. The first time out in the car after the crash on the Isle of Man, and the new seat was taking a little padding to get the right position. Ninth place for now. And rounding out the category top 10 were Neil Williams and Peter James. Happy they had made a reasonable start, but the fog was making the braking points hard to find in places. Things wouldn't be going as well as hoped for Phil and Mick Squires. They break the gearbox casing in stage 2, but with the help of the team they manage to keep things going and lie in 11th place in the category for now. In a couple of class places outside that top 10, it would be second in the D3 class for Gareth Lewis and Jan Griffiths. They lie just 3 seconds ahead of Malcolm Rich and David Jones, who reached the end of stage 2 with third in their class. The new car this season with a lot more power to get used to. Guy Anderson and Stephen Daly lead the way in the D4 class from 15th in the category on an identical time overall to Rich up ahead. And for Rex Ireland and Adrian Stevens, it will be third in the D3 class, a few places further back in the overall category results. Chris Gill and Tom Jordan would be alone in the D2 class, but that wasn't stopping the fun, when they could see of course. They lie 22nd in the category. And just a few places back overall were Stuart and Jack Anderson, second in the D4 class at this stage. They would have an 8-second lead over the Porsche of Edmund Peel and Sarah McDonald, who end this loop with third in the D4 class. So with two stages complete, the results in the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3 look like this. It would be a good start for John Perrott and Keaton Williams. Happy enough with the pace, considering they were back out without any testing. They lead the way for now with a small 6 seconds advantage. Closest to the leaders at this stage were Phil Jobson and Arwell Jenkins, second in the category and the class, and enjoying the first event with the more powerful car. Things were off to a good start for Simon Tyso and Paul Morris. They planned to increase the pace this season, and it was working so far with third place for now. Stan Lior makes a return to gravel after a year at asphalt, and with Guy Weaver alongside for the season, they were settling in well together and leading the C3 class from fourth in the category. For Warren Phylliskirk and Nigel Hutchinson, it would be fifth. They would have almost 20 seconds to catch all, but they did have a similar advantage themselves in that place. Adam Milner and Roy Jarvis lead the way in the C2 class. Problems with a misfire were causing some slower times than they wanted, but they were still going well with sixth in the category. And for Ian Ricks and Steve Greenhill, it would be seventh in the category. They lie just a single second behind Milner at this stage too. There will be intercom problems for Aziz Tejpar and Ross Wittock in the opening stage, which wasn't good given the poor visibility. They reached service with eighth in the category. Mark Tugwell and Steve Pugh were taking it steady, Mark's first rally back since a big accident 3 years ago. For now, it would be ninth place. This event would be only the second Forest event for Elliot Retallick and Tim Tugwell in the Avenger, second in the C2 class now and rounding out the top 10 in the category. And there would be a close fight for third in the C2 class with Stuart and Linda Carris lying in that place and 11th overall. but they will be joined on an identical time by Malcolm Bayliss and Siobhan Pugh, also lying third in the class and 11th overall, a problem that would likely be sorted on the next stage. So at the end of stage two, the results at the top of the Capital Construction category two look like this. The morning stages would be good to Bob and Dale Gibbons. They lead the way in the category and with half a minute of an advantage. That advantage would be over Bob Bean and Malcolm Smithson, leading the way in the B4 class and second in the category. Phil Harris and Graham Wilde were the only mini here this weekend. Phil on his second season back out since a long break, and that pace was getting better as the events went on. And for Mike Barrett and Fiona Scarrett, it would just be relief to even get this far. Problems with the gearbox before the event even begun had cast doubt on them even starting. So with two stages complete, the results in the Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1 look like this. So unfortunately the fog still hasn't lifted here in Wales and the conditions are pretty tricky for the drivers. We've got plenty more action coming up after the break. Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. Just one stage for the crews in this loop, but it would prove to be a tricky one. No change to the lead in this stage for Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark, but the times were getting closer. The mud was causing an issue, but it was, of course, the same for everyone.
One right, Max. 100 logs, middle over flat crest, 150. One right, Max, past lanes, 60. Slippy ahead, two left half long, and three right, mud continues. Two left half long, three right, mud continues. And five left long, logs, five left here. And two left rough, don't cut, muddy, opens, continues for 100. Opens, continues 100, then 200 over mud. 200, muddy continues to one right max, 80, one right max, 80, to four left logs, one right don't cut, four left logs, one right don't cut, 80, 80, mud continues, one right slippy braking, into three left slowing, and square right sharp, square right sharp, go after this. Two left long max, 150.
With the first loop problems behind them, Nick Elliott and Dave Price were able to put in some better times to keep second place and close the gap on the lead down to just 2 seconds now. Sadly for Joe Price and Chris Brooks, it would be a little lost time in this stage. They're not really sure where it was going, but they did have an idea. Third place for now, and hopefully the afternoon would provide a chance to find those lost seconds. Paul Barrett and Di Roberts were still not fully happy with the pace, still trying to get used to things, but for now it would be fourth place and leading the D3 class. Things were still going to plan for Matthew Robinson and Sam Collis. Fifth place at the midpoint, they knew they wouldn't be out to win from the first round, so this was a good start to the development of the car. With the intercom fix, Steve Bennett and Ian Tully had a much better run through stage three. They remain in sixth, but would be more confident going into the afternoon stages. And much the same story for Simon Webster and Jez Rogers. They remain in seventh place, stage three going better than the first two, and they were happy with the pace now. The improvised seat padding for Rudy Lancaster and George Gwynne must have been doing its job as the pair reached midday service with 8th place, a good start after the 5-month break. And for Neil Williams and Peter James, it would be a step up to 9th place, another that would be happier with stage 3 despite the slippery conditions. Sadly for Tim Freeman and Paul Williams, it would be a little slip down to 10th place in this stage, finding the conditions very slippery in there. Outside the top 10, there will be no change to the D4 class lead for Guy Anderson and Stephen Davey. They bring the car back to service in 13th place. The slippery stages were probably not the ideal place to get used to the power of the new car, but Malcolm Rich and David Jones were still keeping things under control to lie second in the F2 class. Change for Rex Ireland and Adrian Stevens as they step up to second place in the D3 class, 18th in the category at this stage. And a step up to third in that class for Ben Friend and Cliffy Simmons, back on a recovery mission after losing 2 minutes in the first loop after pulling over for a suspected puncture. David Kynaston and Paul Wakeley struggle a little this morning, the suspension on the TRA not really working for them, and the car was constantly wanting to swap ends. They do, however, lie second in the D4 class. And third in that class were Stuart and Jack Anderson, 4 seconds behind Kynaston in the class and overall times. So at the midway point, the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3 is shaping up like this. So you're halfway through the day, it looks like the conditions are clearing up a little bit. What's it like out there?
Yeah, it's real bad. The first two, there was quite bad fog patches, so you're just going along and just praying that there's no big rocks at the side of the road, and just commit to the note and listen to Phil. And we said at the start of the stage, if I lift towards the end of the stage, you can tell me off, but in them conditions, I think you had to lift, really. But no, it's hopefully it's clear up now on the hill, but you never know on Epping. It can be snowing there for all we know.
Three stages done. Stage one, I really wanted to be my stage, and unfortunately we had a spin on the hairpin and the engine cut out and we wouldn't restart, so we lost 10 or 15 seconds there, and I knew I had to be quick out the box to hold these young boys from behind, so that's, you know, not helped our times. Stage two was poor with visibility. Three's been a bit better, so we're going to be there or thereabouts with, you know, a good afternoon to do, but, you know, just a little bit annoyed that we just dropped so much time, you know, trying to restart her in stage one, otherwise we'd have had a really good time.
Yeah. How bad is the visibility up there?
It was really the bad one with stage two across the open with the mist came in, and at high speed my wipers weren't clearing the screen. You know, they're old-fashioned wipers in an historic car, so you couldn't really see a lot with the mist and the rain and everything else. So in the trees, it's one and three, it's okay, because you haven't got the speed and you haven't got the mist on you. But on stage two, it was grim.
So you're three stages in, you've got three more stages to go. How are things?
Just a bit messy. I'm just not concentrating enough. Can't get right in the rhythm, but going okay. But there's room for a lot of improvement now, to be honest with you. Like, just been away from us in the car and that, like, so. Looking forward to trying to improve it. I guess really my own fault, just not getting settled in, you know, not constant enough, but happy enough. We're still here is the main thing. The rallying's good, so we'll just keep at it.
So things seem to be going to plan today.
Well, I don't. We're a little bit off the pace, but it's expected, really. But if we can, yeah, I'm pretty happy. If things go, if we can get things together like we've done like that, yeah, it'll be pretty good as the season goes on, I think. So we weren't expecting to bust everybody up today.
John Perrott and Keaton Williams manage to maintain the lead through stage three, but they do lose a little of the advantage, down to 13 seconds now. Change to second place in the category as Simon Tissot and Paul Morris step up to that place at the end of stage three, closing in on the lead, but they had a close fight on their hands. There would now only be a single second between Tissot and the escort of Stanley Orr and Guy Weaver, stepping up to third now and still leading the way in the C3 class. This change of course meaning a move down to fourth place in the category for Phil Jobson and Arwell Jenkins. The change to BDA Power obviously not going as well in the muddy third stage of the day. And Jobson would have to watch out as he would have Warren Phillips-Kirk and Nigel Hutchinson closing in, with just 3 seconds between the two crews at the midpoint in the event. The misfire really hadn't been doing Adam Milner and Roy Jarvis any favours, but they do keep a healthy sixth place in the category going into service and remain in the C2 class lead. And indeed, there wouldn't be much change in the rest of the places in the category either, with Ian Ricks and Steve Greenhill remaining in 7th place at this stage, despite bending the steering and having a small off as a result. As is Tejpar and Ross Wittick overcome their intercom problems to remain in 8th place, 23 seconds behind Ricks. And it will be a further 10 seconds back to Mark Tugwell and Steve Pugh, lying in 8th place overall in the category for now. Things were still going well in the Avenger for Elliot Retallick and Tim Tugwell, 2nd place of the C2 class runners and lying in 9th place. And for Stewart and Linda Carris, they escape the grasp of that joint time with Malcolm Bayliss and edge out an advantage in the 3rd place in the C2 class for themselves in 10th overall. So midway through the event, and it's all change at the top of the Capital Construction Category 2 results. So things seem to be going quite well for you here today.
Yeah, they're going well, to be fair. Yeah, we're just back out without a test, but we're just come here today and just have a little play. But no, it's going real well. Yeah, we're pleased.
Are you enjoying it?
Yeah, I am, yeah. A bit rusty, but like with the brake. But no, it's good. Just getting used to the notes again now. He's having to repeat everything, but yeah. Bar that, no, everything's brilliant.
Have you got high hopes for the last 3 stages then?
Just flat out. Just go as fast as I can without going off, really.
Yeah. Yep. So how did the first 3 stages go for you this morning?
First one was good, and the second one was okay as well. But the third one, very slippy and very muddy. But overall, yeah, good, you know, first time out this year, so we've sort of tried to pick the game up a little bit and just see where we are. So we're quite happy with our results at the minute.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, especially with the conditions. So yeah, really happy.
Yeah.
God knows why we're using a stage that's been used for logging. It's a bit horrendous in the last stage, but apart from that, good, no problems.
So halfway through the day, Stanley, how are things going?
Going good. Taking a bit of settling in. Haven't been doing a lot of gravel in the last year or so, so it'll take a wee while to get settled in. And Guy Weaver's with me now, and new co-driver, so we're starting to get together, and it'll take a wee bit of time to get it all going, you know.
I don't think you're the only one, though, that's taking a while to really sort of get a bit more settled in and find your feet and stuff, and the weather isn't really helping, is it?
It's not brilliant out there, no. It's not the best place to come and try and build your confidence in gravel again, but that last stage, the first two, okay, the last one I enjoyed, so...
Good.
As long as I start to enjoy them again, that's the main thing.
Yes, well, enjoy the afternoon.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
No change to the lead for Bob and Dale Gibbons in this loop, but the advantage at the top still wasn't a safe one. They go into the second half of the day being chased down for that category lead. And it would still be Bob Bean and Malcolm Smithson chasing them down. The gap was a small one, and with 3 more stages to go, anything was possible. And for Phil Harris and Graham Wilde, it will be 3rd. The stage is holding up well for the little mini, riding the bumps really well. With the loss of Mike Barrett from the results, it's just 3 crews remaining in the Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1. And the times look like this.
So I was going to ask you how things are going today, but tell me about last night first.
Yeah, it was a minor shock. I'm going to scrutineer and it wouldn't go to 3rd. Wouldn't go up or down into 3rd. And it worked perfectly the day before. Sod's law, isn't it? So, got to thank Bob Bean, top bloke. He lent me a spare gearbox and we rebuilt it last night. Well, we finished it at 10 o'clock this morning. Started at 10:15, so it was tight. But, touch wood, it's fine.
So how have the first 3 stages gone then with the new gearbox?
Gearbox is fine. Visibility is terrible. Can't see. So you can hear the note, but you can't see the corner. So it's a bit hairy. But the stage is holding up well. I'm surprised, you know, 100 cars have been through. They're quite good. See what happens this afternoon when there's 200 been through. But so far, pretty good.
Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners.
So we're halfway through the day with the crews having to repeat the same 3 stages again this afternoon. Jason Pritchard leads at the moment, but we all know that that can change in just 1 stage. So let's bring you some of the action from this afternoon's stages. On to the next loop of stages, and a repeat of this morning's loop, and the conditions were not much better. No problems for Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark. They have a good run to continue holding on to that lead of the event. The advantage in the place had grown, with Joe Price and Chris Brooks now taking up second place, 26 seconds back from the leaders. The reason for that change would be yet more problems for Nick Elliott and Dave Price. An overshoot in stage four would cost the pair time and leave them not only chasing the position for the lead, but also for second place.
Oh well. Yeah. Deceptive Heaven Left Titan's bad. Heaven Left Titan's bad.
No issues for Paul Barrett and Di Roberts. Safe to say they were up to a good pace right from the start. They remain fourth and leading the D3 class.
Square right plus in, here's your square. In the six left in. And turn, six left, cut of a bump, okay. 18 right through bump dip. In the four left, over crash, cut late. 100 down. Jump and dip. Bad bump bridge, remember. Two right plus plus. In over crest, then three left plus plus in. 40 plus plus crest, then plus one left plus plus in. 100.
No change for Matthew Robinson and Sam Collis. They remain in fifth place and with a reasonable advantage in that position. A much better couple of stages for Steve Bennett and Ian Tully, the second rally for the pair co-driving together, and things were going well. They'll be chased down though by Simon Webster and Jez Rogers, just 6 seconds behind with one stage to go. And there wouldn't be much change in the last few places in the top 10 as Rudy Lancaster and George Gwynn remain eighth in the category. With Neil Williams and Peter James ending this loop with ninth, second place in the class still for the pair. And it would still be Tim Freeman and Paul Williams that round out the top 10 in the category with one stage remaining. So with that one stage remaining, the top of the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3 looks like this. So one more stage to go. How did those last two stages go?
Yeah, they weren't too bad. On Route 60 again, it was really foggy, so you know, we just took our time as best we could. It was cracking, it was very rough, so the cars had a bit of a punning, which is a shame because it's all brand new underneath and it's probably second hand now. So no, just keep it going as it is, and it'll be quite tricky now this last stage because a lot of logging, and obviously the first pass over, it'll be very rough in there, I think.
Yeah.
Well, it started a bit dodgy. We had a couple of spins in the first stage, but stage two went to right, and stage three went to right as well. Yeah. Even though we dropped some time in stage three, but we were at dinner time. We weren't too bad off, actually. We were quite pleased.
Do you know why you dropped that time?
I don't know. It's a bit of a mystery, really. You think you're somewhere near, and then a stage, Nick and Jason just took 10 seconds, 10, 13 seconds off me, and I got a few ideas of why it could have been, but you know, we're not too worried at this stage, to be honest.
Are you going to go into the final stage then, trying to put your foot down a little bit, make up for that time or not?
Well, we had a puncture on the last stage, so we've dropped a bit further back now. So I think we're just going to go for the end now, okay. Just get to the end and not worry too much about it.
So tell me about stages four and five then.
Not good. No, I really went for it, and we had an overshoot in three, and same thing, stalled, wouldn't restart. So another 15 seconds sat there trying to get it to go. Sasa's done, really. Four was terrible with the wipers and the speed. So, we've had a rotten day, really. Problems every stage. So it'd just be, you know, get to the last one and get to finish and just see where we are. But we'd be nowhere near the lead. But, you know, just been a bad day right from the word go.
So last time we saw you, you were underneath your car, and you're just about to go back underneath that car. Tell me all about the problems that you're having today.
On Route 60, I hit the first bridge, and I didn't think it was going to be as bad as it was, and it broke the tower off the back of the gearbox. So that was now able to slide backwards. So Marion made a bracket to bolt it to stop it sliding backwards. We got away with the next stage, came back in, another litre of oil in it. And then he made a bracket for the other side, and then it was completely off at this point. So another elite royal now, but it's a stiff gear change, but it's not holding us back. It's not. There's no excuses there at all. It's been fine. So just get this other 9 miles out of the way and take it home and get it repaired.
Yeah. Good luck.
Thank you.
With just one stage remaining, it would be 11 seconds of a lead for John Perrott and Keaton Williams now, looking good for the category victory at round one. Stanley Orr and Guy Weaver were still chasing the pair down. It wasn't over yet, but they were planned to just get to the finish now. Things were still going well for Simon Tyso and Paul Morris. They keep hold of third, although slipping a few seconds further back in that place. With the misfire easing up, Adam Milner and Roy Jarvis could push a little more. Fourth place for the pair in the category now. And for Warren Phillips-Kirk and Nigel Hutchinson, it would be fifth, just a single second behind Milner with the final stage to go. Phil Jobson and Arwen Jenkins were still learning, and things were going okay, sixth place at this stage. And for Mark Tugwell and Steve Pugh, it would be seventh, the journey from Mark's home in France worth the while so far. The small off in the previous loop wasn't affecting Ian Ricks and Steve Greenhill, eighth place for now. And for Aziz Tejpar and Ross Wittock, it would be another 22 seconds back to 9th place in the category. While Elliot Retallick and Tim Tugwell continue their good run in the Avenger to round out the top 10. So just the final stage remaining and the Capital Construction Category 2 results are looking like this. So you're just about to go into your final stage, and I must admit, your car's looking pretty clean.
Yeah, no, we've had a couple of good stages. We had a couple then, which were, Stanley's just taken a couple out of us now and reduced the lead for me and Stanley to, like, was 14, I think, down to 11 now. So, but I think I don't like the fog very much. I'm just struggling a bit, but I don't know. Yeah, we'll see.
So final stage to go. How have those two been?
A lot better. Yeah. Getting a bit of pace up there in those last two, and cutting up a wee bit, but still good stages, very good stages.
Are you getting used to having Guy as your co-driver now?
Well, we're gelling, and yeah, it's working very well for me. Hope it's the same for him, but it's certainly working well for me. Yeah.
So how do you think you're going to plan the next stage then? Are you going to be able to pick up the pace a little bit?
I don't think we'll change much today. We'll just try and get the finish now at a good pace, you know, and wait for the next one.
Bob and Dale Gibbons managed to hold off any change in these stages to keep hold of that lead in the category, 11 seconds of an advantage. Meaning that Bob Bean and Malcolm Smithson needed a good final stage if they were to take the first victory of the season. And for Phil Harris and Graham Wilde, it would still be third, still going strong in the little mini while bigger cars were falling by the wayside. So, it's still all to play for in the lead of the Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1 going into the final stage of the event. So, not many of you Cat 1 cars out today. Why do you think that is?
Well, I quite understand why the MSA had to change the running order rules. Unfortunately, it means that Category 1 cars have to run towards the back of the field, and that means we're running in some pretty rough conditions, and that means people don't want to damage their cars. I know the MSA are very aware of this issue and are actively looking at steps to try and improve the position.
How have you found being out in your lovely little mini today?
Well, I've got a new co-driver in Graham Wilde. It's the first time we've sat together, and he was saying he couldn't believe how it rode all the bumps and dips and things. So we've gone well today.
Yeah. On to that final stage then, and a repeat of stage 3 with a slight change at the start. Phil Harris and Graham Wilde have a good run to finish the event in one piece, and with second in the category at the finish. The reason for that second would be a loss of Bob Bean and Malcolm Smithson. Sadly, an electrical failure would put them out in the final stage. Which means that the win this weekend goes unchallenged, as Bob and Dale Gibbons cross the finish line, a well-deserved and overdue category win. Before we chat to Bob, here's a reminder of the final results in the Vintage Car Radiator Company Category 1. So category one win, well done.
Yes, indeed. I think it's about time. We've been sort of really struggling on this event for a couple of years with the snow and ice last year and the year before. And Dale's worked hard. We lost our intercom on the fourth stage or the fifth stage, I don't know which one it was. And he was all hands and signals and shouting, and so we were a bit nervous there. But yeah, we're glad we're home. It was very, very rough in there, very wet and very slippery. But yeah, we finished, so that's really good for us actually though.
Is that kind of one of the worst things that can happen, an intercom to go down?
Well, I think it is actually, yeah, especially when you know you're a mile into the stage and it was uphill into an airpin left and it didn't go down, it went dead, and I could hear nothing at all. So then he started shouting and you know, doing sort of all sorts of signals and things. So yeah, I think that is about the worst thing that, you know, that can happen, other than crashing, yeah. Obviously, so yeah. Yeah.
Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. Change in the final stage as Malcolm Bayliss and Siobhan Pugh managed to step up to third in the C2 class at the finish of the event. A good finish for Stuart and Linda Karras as they end the event with a fantastic ninth place in the category and second in the C2 class. As is Tejpar and Ross Whittock take eighth place, a good advantage in that place, and taking sixth in the C5 class. For Ian Ricks and Steve Greenhill, it would be fifth in that class. They finish with 26 seconds of an advantage in that place. A successful weekend for Mark Tugwell and Steve Pugh. Mark's trip back to the UK being rewarded with sixth place here at round one. And it was a good weekend overall for Phil Jobson and Arwell Jenkins. The switcher car seems to have gone well, and it will be about increasing that pace as the season unfolds. Sadly for day-long leaders John Perrott and Keaton Williams, it will be problems in the final stage, pulling over with gearbox issues and dropping down to finish fourth. That meant for Adam Milner and Roy Jarvis it would be the final podium place in the category, a great end to what started out as a bad day with that misfire. And a good run for Simon Tissot and Paul Morris would continue into the final stage, giving the pair second place in the category at the finish. But that means that victory in the category here at round one will go to Stanley Orr and Guy Weaver, the new pairing and the return to gravel working perfectly this weekend. So before we chat to the winners of the Capital Construction Category 2, here's a reminder of the final results. So you two appear to be a match made in heaven, considering this is your first time out and you've just won a category. How does it feel?
Very good. Brilliant, actually. Very, very happy. Very, very pleased.
Yeah. Very happy. I think if we can dedicate this one to Mr. Stokes. He's got an eye on us.
Absolutely, yes. Do you think he had something to do with that today?
He taught me a lot, I know, yes.
So, I mean, I spoke to you earlier on in the day and you really didn't have high hopes at all. You know, you weren't really going to push in that final stage, but...
No, we didn't think so. John, it was hard luck for John. He was a few seconds in front of us, but yeah. It was a good enough lead, but I think he had a problem and... There we are.
Yeah, but you obviously were doing something right today. Obviously, you worked well. It was a good partnership.
Yeah, good. Yeah, we still work further. We've got to get used to each other a little more. Stanley uses a different note system, six fastest, which I'm getting my head around. But I'm pushing him on route 60. He said, "What does believe six right mean?" And I said, "Well, look at the stage time, and that tells you what it means."
Very good. It was, yeah.
Not much would change in the classes over the last stage. Stuart and Jack Anderson rounding out the top of the D4 class at the finish. And for David Kinnison and Paul Wakeley, it would be second in that class. New Springs would be the order of the day for the next round to try and correct that handling. Rex Ireland and Adrian Stevens don't quite manage to keep hold of their class place, ending the event with third in the D3 class this weekend. And for Guy Anderson and Stephen Davey, it would be a good finish to the opening round with the D4 class win. Ben Friend and Cliffy Simmons put the problems on stage two behind them to climb a little further up the results in the afternoon and end the event with second in the D3 class. On to the top 10 in the category, and it will be 10th place for Tim Freeman and Paul Williams. A good finish considering the early problems. Neil Williams and Peter James managed to finish off 9th and taking 2nd in the F2 class at the finish. Rudy Lancaster and George Gwynn get back into the swing of things. The accident on the Isle of Man now behind them, and they end the event with 8th place. Simon Webster and Jez Rogers finish a further 10 seconds ahead of Lancaster in 7th place. A good result for the pair, doing what they need to do for a finish. Sadly for Matthew Robinson and Sam Collis, they would lose a few seconds in the final stage with a small teething problem, but it was job done as far as mileage and development of the car was concerned. Steve Bennett and Ian Tooley have a good run on their second event together, bring the car home in a fantastic 5th place overall. And a faultless drive from Paul Barrett and Di Roberts. Certainly no loss of pace since the last time out, and they finished the event with 4th overall and the D3 class win.
60, one right plus in, 100. To middle of a plus crest, 150. One right plus hook. 60, slippy ahead. Watch this now, Paul. 2 left half long hook into care. 3 right sudden, 5 left long.
What's that?
2 left half long into 3 right sudden, 5 left half long. Fine, here's your 5 left long. Into 2 left plus, very long. 2 left plus, very long, don't cut. Very rough. 200, watch your mud now down here. To 1 right plus. 1 right plus. 80, keep it clean. To 4 left hook. 80, keep it clean. To 4 left hook.
Sadly for Joe Price and Chris Brooks, the second place they gained in the previous loop would soon be taken back. Third was a great finish, especially considering the pair don't always make it to round one of the season. But that means for Nick Elliott and Dave Price, it's the runner-up spot. The win had been lost earlier in the day, and this was all about damage limitation. It may not have been the win, but the points from this round will set the pair up nicely for round two. But taking the win this weekend and starting off the defence of the title in the best possible way were Jason Pritchard and Phil Clark. Despite problems around them, the lead would only be 13 seconds, giving the championship a nice close battle to start the season as we need to go on.
One right max, logs, 40. One left max, 150. 150. To two left long, fast, over bump. Bump on exit, this one. 40 up, one right max. One right max, 100. One left, logs, 40. Slowing small crest, 40 down, slippy. Six right sharp. Into one right and one left. One right and one left. 40, turn 9 right. And 2 left. 2 left, 100. 2 left, 100. Square left, sharp. Don't cut. Don't cut. 4 right plus. 4 right plus. 200. 2 left, fast. 60. 1 left, max. 130 to 3 right short and 12 left over finish. 3 right short, 12 left, remember, over finish. 60, 1 left and 1 right. Well done, you're through. Well done.
Cheers, Phil.
Well done, mate. Well driven.
Cheers. Spot on again.
So before we chat to our winners, here's a reminder of the final results in the RSR Historic Engineering Category 3. Well done, Jason. A win here again. How's it feel?
Yeah, it's brilliant. That's what we came here to do, is try and get some good points to start off the season. And it's a perfect day, really. It was quite rough on the last couple, but I believe we had quite a good cushion going into the last stage, so we just used our heads and tried to keep it tidy, and hopefully it was enough.
I don't think anybody else would describe today as a perfect day, but you obviously used all of the negatives to your advantage and played on it.
Yeah, you can't do much about the weather and the road conditions. You just have to drive to what it is. And, you know, me and Phil did that. And it's a perfect job again by him and the boys in service. So, you know, it's credit to them and Viking Motorsport that we can get another win.
Well, that's it. Round one of the Mintex British Historic Rally Championship is done and dusted. Jason Pritchard managed to defend his championship from last year, but can he keep it up? We'll find out at round two, Rally North Wales, and we'll see you there. Coverage of the BHRC is brought to you by our TV partners. While the historic rallying world welcomed the start of a new season, there would also be sadness, as multiple historic champion and veteran of the sport, David Stokes, sadly lost his battle with cancer. Hardly an event went by where the distinctive Mark 1 escort of David wasn't battling it out for the lead, entertaining rally fans and fellow competitors with his driving on the stages and his enthusiasm off them. His name may be missing from the entry, but his memory certainly isn't.